thanks for making it to our talk. We're going to give you an overview of the entire architecture of what we call real-time connected fitness system. In reality, it is actually an app that users take to the gym that assists them with their exercise. And what I mean by that is, if you take a look at all the gym apps that are available now, they require the users to do an awful lot of typing. And I actually really, really hated that. So I thought, maybe there is a chance to build something else. And so a couple of years ago, I started exploring all these sensors. Back in the days, it was Pebble, the watch, and now Apple Watch with the latest, you know, watchOS 3, which gives me real-time access to the sensory data. And then the natural question was, would it be possible to use that to somehow assist the users in classifying and labeling the exercise that they're doing? And well, it turns out that it is possible, and we've built it, and we're going to tell you all about it. So, as you might expect, the application suggests a sequence of exercises. So if you ever go to the gym, and if you have like a paper log, which is what I started with, then the most natural thing to do is to say, well, what did I do last time? And you sort of flip the page and go, okay, oh, I was going to do that. You check perhaps the weight, the number of repetitions, the intensity, and then you decide whether you want to go up, down, or stay the same. So, well, that's the first thing, right? It needs to learn that. It needs to suggest the right exercise in a sequence of exercises. It needs to suggest the right sequence of exercise sessions. Again, people train in a particular way. It needs to give tips on proper exercise form. So we can even go down to that, because we monitor, we ingest actually in real time. So, you know, when many people say real time, they mean quick. It has to be real time, as the sensors are read from the watch. There is, of course, small hardware buffer, and there's a delay of the Bluetooth connection to the phone, but then we do all the computation on the phone. And we have to do that because a delay of more than about 150 milliseconds makes it unusable. So if you imagine counting repetitions, if the phone is lagging more than 150 milliseconds behind what you're actually doing, it's incredibly confusing and users hate it. It's unusable. So you have to forget any round trips to the server for immediate feedback. It has to be all local computation. And that's, you know, that's the pattern with even IoT. So if you think about sensors around, say, your house, and then you have a local aggregator, it's that local aggregator that has to do the immediate computation. So this is kind of application of the same thing. Now, of course, the elephant in the room in all of this is that if the user has a watch on their wrist, and we say we use the accelerometer data and gyroscope data from the wrist, all that has to happen is the user just holds the hand steady and exercises with the other hand, and we're stuck, right? We see nothing. We have partnered with a company that makes smart clothes. So they make strain gauges, and they sort of sew in and bake into the fabric, these smart fabrics, and then they provide a Bluetooth sensor that sends the data out. And that's actually brilliant. So if you have what we call a fully wired human, then we're not in the dark at all. Now, we're many months away from making it actually look reasonable. So it's not something that you would want to be seen in, but it works as a proof of concept. It's brilliant. We explored using this code base for physiotherapy. So we build these general models from clusters of users, and then we can classify exercise. That's kind of good. We can provide tips on form, again, for general exercise, for general groups of people. But we can train a model for a specific one person, and we can make it very, very overfitted for just that one person. So the experiments that we're running now is, if you get injured, you go to a physiotherapy session, we can train a particular model specifically for that patient, specifically for that exercise. Now, there's a lot of work that we have to do, because if then you don't do the exercise correctly, we can't tell you that you're not doing the exercise correctly. The only thing we can tell you is we don't recognize what you're doing. So it's troublesome, right? We don't give hints as to what you should do. Just say, this is not it. You should do something else. But anyway, this is what it looks like under the hood. So we have code that runs on Pebble and Apple Watch. We have a whole bunch of iOS code that does the immediate, the forward propagation, essentially, of the sensory data down to labels that recognize, identify the exercises. Once the users typically complete an exercise session, we submit the entire sensory data, plus now confirmed labels as part of the user interface. When you finish the exercise, the app says, okay, did you just do this? And if you're happy with it, just leave it, you know, no interaction. You can tap in and say, yes, this is what I've done, and you can give indication of what was the weight, how did you find it, was it hard, was it easy? So this gives us a really rich set of labels on top of all the sensor data that we collect. So that gets submitted, plain old HTTP, nothing too complicated. That gets submitted to our Akka cluster. So this is Scala and Akka, which represents our distributed domain, which holds things like user profiles, it holds user statistics, normal things you would expect from an exercise app. And the Akka cluster writes two things into Cassandra. First, it's a CQRS ES system, so we can scale it to deal with the demand, and we can reason about mutable state. And we can then replay all the events from a journal to get a view on the current state of the system, of the user. So all the journal entries go into Cassandra. And of course, that wouldn't be sufficient, right? I mean, that would be really difficult to then read these blobs, you know, serialized. We use protobuf, but it doesn't matter, right? It's just blob of a message. So we actually write out the sensor values in a normal structured form into Cassandra. Then we have a set of Spark jobs that deal with clustering. So what we found is that different people, you know, different body shape, different genders, they exercise in a different way, obviously. So we simply cluster the people by their sex, by age bracket, by self-reported exercise ability. So, you know, someone says, like me, you know, slightly elderly, a man, and you know, thinks that he's doing quite well with exercise, so that's one cluster and so on. Now we take the data, all the sensory data from these clusters, and we compute, we fit the data to models, and we pass in the model parameters and hyperparameters again to Cassandra that the Akka cluster reads. So when you run the app for next time, we contact the Akka cluster and we say, is there a new set of parameters and hyperparameters for this kind of user? And so the app, this whole thing represents essentially a learning system. So, you know, machine learning is nice, but you need to have something that can get better, and where you've captured the process of getting the data, getting the correct labels, and then doing some computation and reevaluation. Throughout all of this, it's actually really important to think about privacy. You're submitting some very, very sensitive data. So first thing you can think of is to use unstable identifiers. Never tie the sensory data back to a user. That's problematic for us because it damages our clustering. So we have to carry a lot of redundant data. It's not sufficient to just say, this is a block of data from UUID 7. So we have to say, this is UUID 7. It is, you know, someone like me. And here's the sensory data, because the app resets this unstable identifier as frequently as it likes. For physiotherapy, at every session, it shouldn't be possible to identify the user's back. Okay, so I'll go through, you know, set of technologies really quickly before Annie gives us an overview of how we actually run it, you know, what goes into Cassandra, because you can imagine there's a lot of stuff that goes in. So we focused on iOS, mainly because I had the hardware. And so this is the local aggregator. It gets the data from the sensors. It does the real-time processing, real-time, as it happens with the delay of Bluetooth. But, you know, we do a lot of the computation in hardware. So if you've ever tried doing programming with the Accelerate frameworks, with VDSP, it is fantastic. You can get a lot of computation out of a simple, small device, and you can save a lot of battery power. There's, of course, Akka cluster, so if you've ever heard of this horrific acronym called SMAC, this is the A in it. So it's a distributed domain, a CQRS ES implementation that allows us to, you know, reason, it allows us to scale up and down, it allows us to distribute the load across multiple nodes, and in terms of functionality, right, the two big things it does, it needs to serialize the event in some reasonable format that get written to the journal. So if you're ever doing this on your own, don't ever fall for the default Java IO serialization. That will hurt you. You won't be able to recover. All you have to then do is add a field to your case classes, and you're done. It will not deserialize. So you have to think about versioning of all these messages. Think about the reliable serialization. We ended up using Protobuf, but you know, if you want to use Avro or something else, go for it. And then it writes the sensor data in readable format, in something that components outside of the Akka world can read. And then we have Spark. I mean, this all sort of sits together. You can see how it all sort of combines. Distributed computation framework, we do the only big data task that we do is just the clustering. We need to slice the sensory data that we have into groups of people by, you know, their profile. I'll call it profile. And the good news about this is that it runs in batches. So you can think about the load on Cassandra. We have lots of writes, and then once a day we have a batch read. So, you know, we don't have to worry about combining reads and writes at the same time. For the machine learning side, we are currently running on Python and Neon specifically. So Neon has all the usual suspects in linear and tensor algebra. It has a lot of signal processing work, and it has enough pleasant to use convolutional network code. So that's what we use. And we've written, obviously, training and evaluation programs that operate on the sensor data that we receive. And finally, since we're at Cassandra Summit, this whole thing, all bits of data go into Cassandra. So everything that we write, that we touch, ends up in Cassandra. The journals and snapshots of the Akka cluster, the sensor data store, the model hyperparameters and parameters, and what I'll call summaries. So people will want to see, like, you know, what is my average, exercise duration? What is my average exercise intensity? So it gives us all the cool things, right? High availability, no single point of failure, high volumes of read and writes, if we combine it carefully, which we're lucky to be able to do that. We can tune the replication factor, we can tune the consistency level. So for different loads, so think about the Akka cluster journal that has different replication and consistency level requirements versus the sensory data, which again fall into different groups. Okay, there's the Spark job, which I mentioned. It's really trivial. I mean, it sounds grand, right? We deploy this Spark cluster, but it's just clustering. The biggest challenge in all of this was what I like to think is production machine learning, or this learning system. We have complicated work with expanding this sensor data, because when we did all our experiments, it turned out that these fully wired humans are the most valuable ones. So they have all these sensors wired to them. But if we just train all our networks on all these inputs, then we can only classify these fully wired humans again. So we needed to slice all of this. So if someone is wearing an Apple Watch, it gives us accelerometer and gyroscope and heart rate on the wrist. So we needed to expand that into just the gyroscope on the wrist, and just accelerometer on the wrist, and just the heart rate on the wrist, and accelerometer and gyroscope on the wrist. You get the idea. So we generate a lot of data, a lot of computation. Just if you want the details, but by all means, talk to us after the talk. It's all sampled at 50 hertz. The smart clothes sample at 10 hertz, but we upsample it to 50 hertz. That's a fairly trivial task to do. And finally, and this is not the code that's on our GitHub just yet, but we're moving to deep learning for J. We're actually, you know, Java people at heart, so we didn't really like the Python experience. So we're bringing it all into deep learning for J, which is now really reliably usable. It's reached a version where it works. It really works. Okay, so well, this is the entire architecture. And this is how it all fits together. Now, we have Annie here who took all the code that I've written, which was fantastic, but now it needs to run, of course. We got some people, some really fit people, and so the idea of telling them, well, we're really sorry we lost your data, but thank you for your exercise, really wasn't attractive to us. So this man made it run.
Thank you, Jan. As you could see that I don't go to gym, so I don't really care what's happening there. So it was, so far you've seen that the developers have decided that they would, they're gonna use a lot of different languages, a lot of frameworks, a lot of different sort of core service components to solve all of their problems. And then they have said that, right, okay, we've got this thing running somehow in our laptops. We need to, can you put this laptop into cloud? So that's where things started getting a little bit more interesting. We were a small team, so there were some time limitations and resource limitation and also interest limitations. Not all the guys would actually be interested into sort of finding out how can we run Spark properly on cloud, AWS cloud. Failures, embrace failures, Spark nodes go off, Cassandra dies. So they left it on me and a few of our DevOps guys to say that, right, okay, you guys figure out how you want to do this. So before we started, we were very clear in terms of what we were actually trying to achieve. So, and we knew that to successfully build a system of that complexity, we need to make sure that the development on that system is going to be very easy and very simple. If we actually have to move with enough velocity to actually get the features out of the door. So the choice of tool set and how we actually string those tools together in terms of managing an infrastructure which would hold, or rather an infrastructure which provides you a platform where you can run this application. We needed to make sure that orchestration of that infrastructure was easy. We need to make sure that the platform would actually support lots of different languages, would be able to support lots of core service components. And more importantly, because when we were starting, we didn't know whether this thing going to work or not, is people going to pay their own money to actually use this or not. So cost was also a big factor. So we need to make sure that development and experimenting on this platform is easy and cheap. So very early on, what we decided that if we have to make sure that our developers are happy in developing on this thing, we need to make sure that these are all on containers so that we can actually run Kafka, Cassandra, Spark, our different microservices on a developer's laptop so that they can actually try this sort of test the features properly before they push it out, because we are actually going to build it on AWS, which is going to cost us. So every one bug would actually cost us dollars. So if we actually find, the sooner that we can identify, okay, this code is not ready to go into cloud, the more money that we save. So Docker was good, microservices and all that, really good, but persistence workload in Docker, that may be another talk of how interesting that is. So we needed to find a platform which would actually allow us to run Cassandra as containers, Kafka as containers, our microservices as containers, and would give us this nice developer-friendly workflow that you actually write a little bit of code, push it, that gets tested on AWS, and as actually seamlessly promoted onto production. So before I move on to the tool set, I owe this to Cassandra Summit, because I learned this in last year's Cassandra Summit from one of the cool talks from InstaCluster guys. So this has helped our team so much that initially when we were actually running and testing our code, we were actually running on single node Cassandra. But having these configuration on your Cassandra env and Cassandra YAML meant that you could actually run a small enough 4-node Cassandra cluster on your laptop and can test your program that is actually running it properly or not.
Surprisingly important if you consider starting your Akka cluster, which typically starts at the same time you run many nodes at the same time. If you're using Akka persistence, it wants to create all the tables at the same time. So you might run into schema disagreements where two processes on separate machines try to create table with the same name, with the same schema, but then, of course, the schema IDs don't agree. So if you're running a single node Cassandra, you'll never see this. Everything works on your machine. And then you take this into production where you have a 3-4 node Cassandra cluster, and all of a sudden, everything breaks at startup. So it's these little tips from Mani's team that really allowed us to unearth these problems at development on these machines, which was incredible help.
Right. So now comes to the cool bit. So we needed to find a platform which would allow us to run all of this. So in search of that, we initially found Mesos as one of our choices of having this platform on. So it would actually abstract over a group of AWS machines, and it's actually going to give us the notion of one single machine with CPU, RAM, disk, network, I/O, and all that. And we're actually going to target, so the developers target their application for this one platform, and they don't really care of how it's actually running on the underlying hardware. Then Mesosphere actually brought out DCOS, or open source DCOS. This was actually a proprietary tool before that, or enterprise tool. Then they decided to actually make it open source so we can then use it. So it's essentially a distributed operating system based on the Mesos distributed systems kernel. It is highly available from the ground up and scalable to really large degree. So we are not running into tens of thousands or even thousands of nodes, but we are into hundreds of nodes at the moment on this project, and good 500 to almost 1,000 node limit on one of our other production cluster as well. So it actually does work quite nicely. So what it does is it actually provides you with some of the core services which we otherwise have to build from our infrastructure team, things like service discovery. So you have got microservices, you have got these other service components, but they need to actually discover each other, and you need to actually join them, and that is actually a hard challenge. But DCOS comes with its own sort of service discovery based on DNS as the first sort of implementation. So I mean, I'm not going to go into the debate of like whether DNS-based service discovery is good or not, but it actually works, and it's been taken care of by someone else, so which is good for us. Monitoring and logging was also a pretty crucial thing. So we have got this one component, or the platform is actually going to monitor and log all of these various other components that we actually had. And it was simple to operate. So running a Mesos cluster was really difficult for us, or get to run a Mesos cluster to production grade was really difficult, whereas sort of maybe 1/4 the time that we spend in running Mesos cluster, we actually had a similar size DCOS cluster up and running on a production grid, so backup and sort of disaster recovery enabled. So so we chose DCOS to run our workload on. So a little bit of sort of like 10,000 feet or probably even 20,000 feet overview of DCOS architecture. So DCOS design distributed operating system. So it's actually based on the Linux operating system design. So the concepts are actually based on that. So you see user space and kernel space, and you can relate to it in terms of like a operating system running on your own machine. So in kernel space, you have got Mesos masters and the Mesos agents. So the Mesos masters are the processes of the machines which are actually going to deal with resources that are actually available in your cluster. So an EC2 instance startup. So the Mesos masters would actually know that, okay, I have got 8 CPU, I've got 32 gigs of RAM, I've got 1 terabyte of hard drive. So the cluster size grows by that. The Mesos agents are actually the machines who actually would run the ultimate tasks. So they would be the ones who would be running the final process that you actually say your microservice or Cassandra or Kafka. So the Mesos masters would actually take these processes and would distribute it based on which machine or which agent has got what capacity in terms of resources. That's kernel space. So then on user space, you have got some of the core system components like DNS, service discovery, packaging. So DCOS comes with a built-in package manager like almost a Unix or Linux distributed system. So you can actually have pre-built packages available there for Cassandra, Kafka, Elasticsearch, Redis. I mean, anything that you can think of is probably have got a package out there already. And it's actually well supported by all the open source community and the commercial offering as well. Like, we're using Apache Cassandra at the moment, but we know that DataStax Enterprise has also come up with their latest version on DCOS. So those would be the system components, and you have got the services. So each service, so as in Cassandra is a service, so that service would be sort of based off a few processes, and these processes are the nodes that would actually build up your cluster. So that's an overview of the DCOS architecture. Now, how do you actually have the, I mean, that was like a logical view of how it's actually been set. So this is pretty much physically, so this is what we can relate to, that you have got the public like subnet, you have got the private subnet, and you have got an admin network where your master nodes would reside in and would allow very specific access to it, because if you get access to your admin nodes, then you have got full control over your cluster, because the admin node has got access to your private subnet as well. So you would run most of your workload would actually run on your private nodes. So workloads like Kafka and Cassandra would actually run on your private nodes. And some of your microservices, which are public facing, say your dashboard or your web app, that is actually suitable for public agents. So you would like roughly have a small amount of public agents compared to your private agent based on your workload again. So that's sort of like a rough overview of like how it's actually physically set up on AWS. Now, how do we actually run Cassandra on it? So there are some sort of key components in here. So the two crucial components of running Cassandra or any service on DCOS is the Cassandra scheduler or the service scheduler and the Cassandra executor or the service executor. So you can sort of swap it out with Kafka would have their own service executor and they would have their own scheduler. So the interesting bit over here is what does this executor and scheduler provide so that we can actually run Cassandra on DCOS. So when a slave joins and says that, okay, I'm a private agent and I've got X amount of CPU, X amount of RAM, and that offer goes off to the Mesos master, and the leader then decides that, right, okay, I would want to start up a 4-node Cassandra cluster, and how many machines do I have? Okay, I have got 3 machines, so I would start up 3 nodes. So the scheduler then says that, right, okay, I accept the offer, and can you run some tasks on it? So, and then the tasks like go to the executor, and the executor then have got a sort of like a number of tasks that it actually does. So it prepares the cluster, it bootstrap the cluster, then it's also configured the cluster, and finally runs the cluster. So it essentially takes care of all the complexity that is usually associated with running Cassandra on cloud. These executors and the combination of scheduler and executor together, it gives us the ability to actually run tasks onto the entire Cassandra cluster in parallel. So the scheduler actually takes care of running backup, running restore, cleaning up, repair, and all these tasks. So that makes it a lot easier for us to actually run a production Cassandra cluster. Now, some of the crucial things of running Cassandra on DCOS has been that it's actually a single command installation, and it's really easy to manage multiple Cassandra clusters, and that's been a really big help for us because we are experimenting a lot, and we would want to parallelly run our experiments to actually see which one actually is better than the other. So imagining a case where we didn't have DCOS and we had to run multiple Cassandra clusters ourselves, that would take a lot of effort, take a lot of programming, but it's really easy to manage it via DCOS. And integrated monitoring. So we would actually have the Cassandra cluster monitoring driven through the DCOS monitoring unit, and it gives a really, really good visual overview of how the cluster is actually performing. The basic monitoring is actually covered really nicely and has got room to actually add your own specific monitoring if you need. Finally, that was all good, but how did we get code up to a system like that? So quickly go through our CI/CD process. We say it as simple, but terms and conditions apply. So source code is changed. Our continuous integration server Jenkins starts building it. Build succeeds. It creates a Docker image, pushes the Docker image to our public Docker registry. At the same time, it also pushes information about that particular Docker image onto another Git repository in terms of setting up the version number, setting up some parameters of which build pipeline was it part of. Following on, based on which build pipeline it was part of, say as an example, if it was the Java microservices which was being run, it would actually then push the configuration in a template format for DCOS to run. DCOS understands mustache templating, so it's actually a form of templating language, so that information is passed on with mustache onto DCOS for the microservice to run. And once you have getting it onto DCOS, then everything is automatic, so DCOS would actually take care of, by default, a blue-green setup is actually applied, so it will run your workload, and it will then take out the blue and would put the green in, or green and then put the blue in. That's about it. So finally, one of the things that made us save some cost was making sure that we can compact our resources as much as we, or rather compact our processes as much as we can onto the resource that we had. We could actually utilize more of the CPU and the RAM and the disk that we had. We also used quite heavily AWS spot instances. Now, DCOS being highly available, it meant that when Netflix would run their workload and they will take away all the machines, we can still survive that because our cluster or our master nodes would be on-demand nodes. Even though the nodes are actually gone for Netflix streaming, we can still survive that. And once new nodes are available, we can pretty much seamlessly start working again. So while development, I really advise using spot instances. But if you can handle that, because it's not going to be there and it's actually going to be reclaimed. If you're running some sort of computing jobs like Spark jobs, those are actually good candidates to be run on spot instances if you want to save some costs. And that's about it, really. So off to Jan.
Yes, okay, well, I'll finish up. Hopefully this all makes sense now. Not only in terms of architecture, which components fit in, where does Cassandra fit in, how does all the API compose together, what is stored in Cassandra, and what other jobs sort of use the data that we store in Cassandra. Clearly, we don't have the scale of Nike and anyone like that. We have 1,000 beta users, but even they generate quite a bit of data, and we've been running for about a year, so we want to keep all of this data, and the workloads that this amount of data generates just keeps growing. So, but at the same time, we don't want to delete stuff away. This is the overall architecture. I'll tweet out all the links. The code is on GitHub, which is encouraging, including some testing data, so you don't have to go to the gym and collect everything yourselves. You can take the few bits that we have. Contact details, and we'll take any of your questions if you're not too hungry. So
the question is, what is the node size for the Cassandra cluster? So we actually follow the recommendation from DataStax. So obviously, when we are in sort of development mode, we sort of use not the production sort of recommendation. So there is a concept in DCOS where you can actually pin processes into the kind of agents that we would have. So that would mean that whenever there is a node that's actually starting up, that's actually going to be targeted onto the box, the physical machine, which has got the capability to run that particular process. So that makes sure that whenever we are running our Cassandra like jobs, they would be picked, or the right kind of agent would be picked to run that. Obviously based on configuration, like if it's production, then C4 extra large, or if it is development, then
anything goes, right? We just get given something.
That's correct, yes. Mesos would take care of that, yeah. Yes.
How much data do you have right now?
So the question is, how much data do we have right now?
We are now running at about 20 terabytes now. So it's not massive.
How long does your Spark job work?
We run it nightly, and we have an hour on spot instances. So we're willing to pay for an hour to run the Spark job. I mean, it's a good time unit, especially for AWS. We're running at about 40 minutes now, so we're safe. But we have the Spark jobs aren't as interesting. It's the machine learning jobs are even more interesting. We have obviously the end for the fitting process is when we find a perfect model, right? So if it has perfect accuracy, perfect recall, and all that never happens. So we have of course acceptable level of accuracy and recall. And then there's this hard stop. So we actually run the machine learning fitting every night, but we're willing to give it an hour, actually 55 minutes, just to be sure we don't pay any more. And then at 55 minutes, we kill the machines. They go away. They will have written the results that they have achieved. And then it's a simple job of selecting the best one, which gives us an idea of evolution of the hyperparameters that we have for our system. So we have recorded the data, the training test data that produced the result, and the hyperparameters that produced that result and the result. So we can look at how our models are evolving.
You mentioned that you are using Cassandra.
Yes.
So your Spark cluster is completely different. How do you migrate the data from Cassandra to Spark?
So we use the Spark connector for that.
Yeah.
One final question, do we have time for that? Yeah, one okay, final one.
So if you plan to use deep learning in the future for building a model, so how do you plan to move all the data from Cassandra to your plan with any GPUs or like use tensor framework?
So the question is, if we're going to be using deep learning, so right now our training is in Neon, so it's a Python job that reads the data from Cassandra directly. If we want to move to deep learning for J, what sort of impact will that have? So deep learning for J, we're going to run that in a Spark job. So the only difference, we're not going to use TensorFlow, we're going to use deep learning for J, which is a particular framework. It runs on the JVM. So that will become, they'll move closer to the Spark clustering jobs. So rather than having a second set of programs that then read the data and do the evaluation, we'll sort of collapse everything into a set of Spark jobs, and they will read the data from Cassandra using the Spark connector. At least that's the plan. Now, we have tried deep learning for J with CUDA, and there are some challenges, particularly on AWS machines. It really likes to segfault them. So at the minute, I hope that it will change. But what we found is, you know, it will be necessary, of course, to run it on the GPU, so CPU for deep learning will be unusable. The computation time is incredible. So it will be CPU. There's a framework called ND4J, which is the numerical underpinning of deep learning for J, which has a CUDA implementation. But it's a work in progress. Okay, well, thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Here all day if you have any more questions.